This is Marsha Memorial's Sunday service for February 28, 2021.
Welcome this morning from wherever you are in the world to Marshall Memorial United Church. It is so good to have you with us. Let us light the Christ candle, symbolizing Christ's presence with us. I wanted to begin this morning by taking a moment to thank you for your comments and discussions about last week's service. We do long for the structure and the presence of being in this building, don't we? And many of you, as we talked about the light and the beauty of our sanctuary, we talked about that this week. And what great conversations. We talked about structure this week and how important it is to have those rhythms in our lives. And I was thinking about that structure. I was thinking about how wonderful over this last year the board of Marshall and each person in that board has come together to create a structure of church life, a structure of us to belong to, a structure of belonging for us. And we want to thank the board for their continuous work, their diligence in providing for us the structure of church life. And I was thinking about our worship committee and how they, in their deliberations and in their choices, have helped create a structure in which we may worship. They're the ones that guide us and help us to do the very best in the time that we have together. And we want to thank them for our Sunday morning experience and their leadership in that. I was also thinking in terms of structure about Judy and Christian Development Committee, and how these practices of Lent give us structure to our devotional lives as we live and as we move through these days of February. And you know, the other thing I was thinking about, and one person said that the service looked, and they used this word, I love the word, they used the word regal. They said the service looked regal, and it's an indication of how beautiful our sanctuary is, with the sun bouncing off the pews and the beauties of the colors and the beauty of the wood and everything, and what sacred space this has become to us in our lives as we have worshiped here. We're so very grateful for this as a structure. And it's my joy as your minister to say, you know, that in days to come, the vaccinations will come and this COVID thing will be beaten and we will be together in this place again. We will be here to enjoy the light and the beauty and the sound. The band will be there providing the very best in worship music, and the organ will be playing and giving life to the expression of our heart and our best Christian songs and how we look forward to that. But until we're back into this structure, we live and move and we have our lives in the structure of our church. And that is created by so many great people. Thank you for the conversations this week that have underlined the importance of the people that make up Marshall Memorial United Church. This morning, we have a few younger people participating with us also, fitting into and becoming part of our structure. This is the last Sunday of Black History Month, and we have Kaylin, who is doing a presentation on Harriet Tubman, and Emma is doing a presentation on Rosa Parks, and Emmanuel is presenting Lincoln Alexander for us. And we are so thankful for Heather and all the great stuff she's doing with our youth, and we welcome them into our structure, into our service this morning. So now let's turn to Judy, who will talk to us about this week's structure, this week's practices for our Lenten practices. Judy, welcome.
Hi, everybody. It's Judy here from your Christian Development Committee, and I want to welcome you to week two of Lent. This year, our Lenten study is the book, The Common Rule, Habits of Purpose for an Age of Distraction. This book is helping us cultivate some spiritual practices that are going to help us grow in our faith and to help us as a community to more faithfully walk in God's way and serve in God's world. Each week, we're asking you to try out one daily practice and one weekly practice. Last week, it was the daily practice of prayer three times a day and the weekly practice of a one-hour conversation with a friend. This week, the daily practice we want you to check out is scripture before phone. This means when you get up in the morning, you're going to read the Bible before you start checking your notifications. Now, if the phone isn't the thing that trips you up to set the tone for your day, maybe you're going to modify this slightly. You might do scripture before coffee, although I do scripture with coffee, or maybe scripture before newspaper. Whatever works for you. The point is to start the day with the Word of God. And our weekly habit this week is Sabbath keeping. We are each going to carve out a 24-hour period, hopefully on Sunday, so we're all going to be doing our Sabbath together at the same time. But if not, sometime that works for you throughout the week where you can carve out 24 hours where you are purposefully and intentionally incorporating rest into your schedule. And this might actually be a Sabbath from electronics where you might actually turn your phone off for 24 hours. Who knows? Whatever works for you. The point is to set aside purposefully one day this coming week where you're going to give some extra attention to the really important relationships in your life, including your relationship with God.
Why?
There's no such thing as a diplomatic hand grenade. Of course, that sentence or that phrase talks about the importance and the difficulty and the potentiality of those very difficult conversations that we have. Difficult conversations sometimes are very, very hard to get into and hard to navigate, but the effort that we invest in them, usually worth it. And good things come out of those difficult conversations. Well, Jesus knows that the mission, vision, and values of the Father, the vision of Jesus to die, to substitute himself for our sins, to become us so that we might become him, that we might live in Christ in the newness of his life. He knew that the Father had times and seasons, and those times and seasons were approaching. And he knew the values of self-denial, of choosing the Father's will over that which looks good and in the human eye. Jesus knew those things, and he had a difficult conversation to have with his closest disciples that they might know fully the ways of God and how to choose the way of Christ in the midst of their lives. This passage that we're going to celebrate today and explore, this service, is about Jesus having that difficult conversation. And as the book says, there's no such thing as a diplomatic hand grenade. And Jesus throws a hand grenade into the disciples' lives, one with such power, they really don't realize what it means until much after Jesus is dead, Jesus is risen, and Jesus is exalted. As we are thinking about Jesus having a difficult conversation with his closest disciples, part of that discussion is Jesus reorienting his disciples' very perspective. There is good reason to believe that the disciples expected Jesus to become some type of a popular figure, a figure perhaps even political in nature, and maybe even militarily, Jesus would have power. Of course, Jesus has to reorient his disciples away from this and towards the idea of Isaiah 53 and Psalms like this, Psalm 22, which is a psalm about the crucifixion of the Lord, a prophetic psalm about what would happen in Jesus' life. So let's celebrate our psalm now, Psalm 22, and let's listen for a moment as we listen to our sung refrain. We welcome you this morning to recite the psalm with us as you can read it on your screen. My God, why have you forsaken me? Why are you so far from helping me from the cry of my distress? Oh my God, I cry out in the daytime, but you do not answer. At night also, but I get no relief.
My God,
but you are the Holy One, enthroned upon the praises of Israel. In you our ancestors trusted. They trusted and you delivered them. They called to you and you rescued them. In you they put their trust, and you did not disappoint them. But I am a worm, less than a human, an object of derision and an outcast of the people. All those who see me laugh me to scorn. They curl their lips and toss their heads, saying, you trusted in God for deliverance. If God cares for you, let God rescue you. But you are the one who took me out of the womb. You kept me safe on my mother's breast. On you have I depended from my birth. Even from my mother's womb, you have been my God.
My God, why have you forsaken me?
Do not be far from me, for trouble is close at hand, and there is no one to help me. Many bulls encircle me. Strong bulls of Bashan surround me. They open wide their mouths at me, like a ravenous, roaring lion. My life pours out like water. All my bones are out of joint. My heart has melted like wax within my breast. My mouth is parched as dry clay. My tongue clings to my palate. I lie in the dust of death. Dogs surround me. The wicked hem me in on every side. They bind my hands and my feet. I can count all my bones while they stand staring, gloating over me. They divide my garments among themselves. They cast lots for my clothing.
My God, my God, why have you forsaken me?
Amen.
Good morning, everyone. Hope you're all well and safe, despite the challenges associated with COVID. Please bow your head as we commence with the prayer of the people. Dear Lord, we offer up our prayer and our praise to you. We continue on our symbolic 40-day journey, culminating in the death and resurrection of Christ. This, in fact, is the good news. And so our prayer today will be a joyful noise in celebration of the good news. We thank you for this season of Lent. It is a season of reminders and a season of good news. We're reminded of Jesus' promise to Abraham that he would be the father of many nations, given in grace, based upon faith. This was good news for Abraham and his many descendants. We're reminded of Christ's caution to us. What good is it for someone to gain the whole of the world, yet forfeit their souls? This was given in grace, based upon faith, and it reminds us that the good news is eternal, not of this world. And we're reminded of John's message. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. Jesus was given in grace, based upon faith. This is the good news. Jesus was the Word made flesh. We're reminded as well that we're called to love God and to love our neighbors. This is also the season when we celebrate and recognize Black History Month. Lord, we're reminded that if one of us is unsafe, all of us are unsafe. We are not free of injustice or oppression if one of us is treated unjustly or feels oppressed. We're at the edge of hope and promise in this respect. We're closer to a time that we can live your two great commandments, love God and love our neighbors. Lastly, we're reminded of our Marshall Memorial Community of Faith. And particularly, we are reminded this morning of those who have achieved the venerable age of 80 years plus. We offer them up to you, knowing that through grace you will sustain them during the challenges of COVID. They are an inspiration and a source of joy to all of us. Dear Lord, thank you for your reminders. You know that we're weak and we're needy, we're human. You know that we need reminders. We need reminders over and over and over again. We need Lent as a reminder of your grace. We need Lent as a reminder of the good news of Jesus' resurrection. For this and all other blessings we rejoice, for this is the day that the Lord has made. Thanks be to God. Amen.
Father, God in heaven, hear our prayer.
let us take a moment and pray our Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Rosa Parks. Rosa Parks was a hero of the civil rights movement. On December 1st, 1955, in Montgomery, Alabama, Rosa Parks refused to move when asked by a bus driver to stand and let a white passenger have her seat. She was then arrested. Because of what she did, she inspired the black community to boycott buses for over a year. This was known as the Montgomery Bus Boycott. This became an important symbol of the civil rights movement. The United States Congress has called her the First Lady of Civil Rights and the Mother of the Freedom Movement.
Arianta Ross was born in Dorchester County, Maryland in 1820. She later changed her name to Harriet Tubman. She was born enslaved, and because of this, Harriet's family and other families were separated. Three of Harriet's sisters were taken away and never seen again. One day, a man wanted to take Harriet's little brother, but their mom and dad would not let the man take him. Harriet's mother stood up for the family and wouldn't let the man take anyone else. Harriet saw how her mother protected the family and wanted to do the same thing for others. When Harriet was a little older, she went to work in the fields. When a boy tried to escape, the overseer got so angry he threw a weight. The weight hit Harriet's head. For the rest of her life, she got painful headaches, and sometimes she fainted because of this. When Harriet was a little older, she became a conductor and helped with the Underground Railroad. The Underground Railroad helped people escape enslavement, because they moved people up north where slavery was against the law. Harriet would travel during the winter months and at night because there would be less people around to see them traveling. Safe houses would have candles or lanterns lit to signal that there was safety ahead. Some safe houses would be in basements, barns, and even caves. Harriet completed 13 missions and rescued 70 people through the Underground Railroad. Harriet was also a nurse and spy. She was the first woman to guide soldiers to the enemy. When the Civil War ended, women and men still did not have equal rights. Women were not allowed to vote for their leaders. Harriet went around the country and said this: "There is one of two things I have the right to, liberty or death. If I can't have one, I would have the other." This means she wanted to be free and alive, and if she can't have this, she'd rather be dead. Harriet died March 10th, 1913, in Auburn, New York. The end.
When I was little, I went to Lincoln Alexander School, and it was a big thrill to all the kids when he came to visit every year. Lincoln Alexander was born in 1922 to immigrant parents. In 1939, he moved to Hamilton to make anti-aircraft guns for the war effort. When he was old enough to enlist, he enlisted with the RAF and became a wireless operator. After the war, he earned his BA from McMaster University, and after that, a law degree. He practiced law in Hamilton and opened his own firm. In 1968, Mr. Alexander became the first Black Canadian to sit in the House of Commons, and in 1979, he became the first Black Canadian to serve in cabinet as Minister of Labor. 6 years later, Mr. Lincoln Alexander was sworn in as Lieutenant Governor, and a large part of his mandate was to fight racism and racial discrimination in Canada. Three schools in Canada are named after him, and one freeway that connects Ancaster, Hamilton, and Stony Creek. January 21st is Lincoln Alexander Day. He is remembered as having greatly contributed to the inclusiveness and tolerance of Canada today.
Good morning. Today's scripture reading is taken from Mark chapter 8, verse 31 to 38. Jesus predicts his death. He then began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer many things and then be rejected by the elders, the chief priests, and the teachers of law, and that he must be killed and after 3 days risen again. He spoke plainly about this, and Peter took him aside and began to rebuke him. But when Jesus turned and looked at his disciples, he rebuked Peter. "Get behind me, Satan," he said. "You do not have in mind the concerns of God, but merely human concerns." The Way of the Cross. Then he called the crowd to him, along with the disciples, and said, "Whoever wants to be my disciple must deny themselves and take up their cross and follow me. For whoever wants to save their own life will lose it. But whoever loses their life for me and for the gospel will save it. What good is it for someone to gain the whole world, yet forfeit their soul? Or what can anyone give in exchange for their soul? If anyone is ashamed of me and my words in this adulterous and sinful generation, the Son of Man will be ashamed of them when he comes in his Father's glory with the holy angels."
Again, welcome. And thank you to our children for their contribution to our service this morning. There's no such thing as a diplomatic hand grenade. What a powerful line. And does it ever draw you in? Well, actually, it's a line from this book called Difficult Conversations, How to Discuss What Matters Most. And this is a book, I want to recommend this book because this is a book that will sit on your shelf for years, but boy, when you need some coaching on having a difficult conversation, boy, do you ever need that coaching. And this is a really, really good resource, solid resource for when we have to have those conversations with people. And from time to time, we do, don't we? So, difficult conversations. There's no such thing as a diplomatic hand grenade. And that metaphor refers to the sense of beginning a discussion on something that is potentially explosive, and there's no good way to do that. And that's exactly what Jesus is doing. Jesus, in the Gospel of Mark, and if you think about the way the gospel proceeds and moves toward Easter, towards that climax of death and resurrection and the call for us to be disciples. Jesus understands that the Father's mission to bring humanity into relationship is moving forward, and that the time for this particular vision, the vision of the suffering servant, the one who would be laying down their life, the crucified one, only to be raised again in the power of resurrection and to live therefore as the king. This sense of being the suffering servant is the thing that's moving forward. In the text, Jesus sees that the disciples and everything's happening. Hey, they're making headway, and there's every reason to think that there's going to be a political, popular outcome to the ministry of Jesus. People have high expectations in another way to say it. But Jesus now has to have this very difficult conversation that it's really not going to be that way at all. It's not going to turn out that way, but rather that the suffering will, or the suffering servant as the will of God, will substitute themselves for humanity and on the third day rise again. But before the exaltation, there comes rejection and death and suffering. So the first thing that is said is that Jesus talks plainly. And that's an interesting word because Jesus' strategy in having the difficult conversation is to pick his time well, but to begin to talk openly about what's going on. Jesus says that there will be rejection and there will be death and there will be suffering, and this is what's going on. And it's as if the disciples themselves, although they can hear the words, they can't grasp the true implications of what Jesus is saying. The shift in their mentality is what we're really talking about. If you look at Mark chapter 10, James and John, the two brothers, go to Jesus. I think this is around 35, verse 35. They go to Jesus and they say, Jesus, we want you to do something for us. Oh, yes, I'll do you a favor. Okay. We want to sit at your right hand and your left hand when you enter into your glory. Well, Jesus knows and understands that you don't have a clue what you're really asking. What they're really thinking about is that Jesus is going to become a huge earthly figure, and he is going to be a leader, and James and John want to grab some good spots and good portfolios, if you will, in this kingdom of Jesus as the earthly king, as the political king, as the earthly powerful king. And Jesus has to wrestle them away from that. Wrestle them into, and this is the beginning of Jesus wrestling them into an understanding of an Isaiah 53 ministry. This is what God has. And so I brought Isaiah 53. Listen to some of the things that God says about the one who will redeem God's people. Who has believed what we have heard, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? He grew up before him, before God, like a young plant, and like a root out of dry ground. He had no form or comeliness that we should look at him, no beauty that we should desire him. He was despised and rejected by people, a person of sorrows and acquainted with grief. And as one from whom people hide their faces, he was despised, and he was esteemed, and we esteemed him not. Surely he who is referring to Jesus has borne our griefs, he carried our sorrows, yet we esteemed him stricken, smitten by God, and afflicted. But he was wounded for our transgressions, he was bruised for our iniquities, and upon him was the chastisement that made us whole, and with his stripes we are healed. And we, like sheep, have gone astray, we have turned every one to their own way, and the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. That is the prophetic ministry that Jesus would live out before the disciples. Well, that's not what they're expecting. So Peter, full of love, but not so full of discretion as we find Peter, Peter rebukes Jesus. Now, the interesting thing here is that rebuke actually comes in the form, perhaps, of a hug. It's not the word rebuke that we would think about where there's a connotation of a hard rebuke, you know, and we use that word in English today, he was rebuked. But in the language here, the body language together seems to say that this was really more the loving words of Peter the friend. No, Lord. And one commentator even said that it happens in a hug, that Peter hugs his friend friend that he loves, Jesus. And he says, no, this kind of thing can't happen. You can't talk like that. And then in body language, Jesus pushes Peter away, symbolizing, get behind me, or get there, symbolizing the difference between where Jesus really knows that he is on his way and the intentions, even the very lovely, greatest intentions that Peter has for Jesus, get thee behind me. And then Jesus labels it. He labels it, Peter, you're thinking about the things of this world and not about the things of God. And it's as if Jesus is finishing that sentence as saying, I can exclusively think, focus on the things and plans, the mission, vision, values of God at this time. And then Jesus adds that word that this interaction becomes famous for, doesn't he? He says, get behind me, Satan. Speaking over Peter's shoulder to the spirit that propels Peter's message. It's as if that Peter is loved so much by Jesus that the words of Peter are allowed to come into the soul of Jesus. He loves Peter, and therefore he has to distinctly push Peter off, that as an example of the sense of even my closest friend, I must put behind me as I focus exclusively on the will of my Father in heaven. And then we have this rebuke of the rebuke, we might call it. Jesus teaches the multitude, gathers people together, and Jesus begins to teach them, as Megan read. He begins to teach them about self-denial as a principle of following in the kingdom of God. Now, Jesus himself is living that out. He's exemplifying what he's teaching as he moves toward the self-denial that Easter, and we're in Lent, right? We're preparing for Easter. And Jesus is living out that self-denial as he moves forward. So we are getting here a teaching of Jesus, and we will be supported in that teaching all the way along by Christ's example. But there's a couple of neat things that happen here. There's a couple of words that Jesus uses, and they're only used here in our New Testament. So self-discovery through self-surrender is the big theme. That accepting God's way means being willing to lose everything else. Being able to lose everything else. That word lose is a particular word. And one commentator or one translation, it's actually, they use the word to be fined, because it means that, it connotes that, it carries the meaning that as you give your whole soul to something, necessarily there are other things that you cannot or nor will ever be able to do because you've given your soul to this. And in a sense, if you gave your soul to this and your whole body, soul, and purpose to the things of the world, to the things that are, again, using Peter and Jesus' discussion, to the things of the earth, then necessarily there's not time. You can gain the whole world. But what would that do if in the process your very soul is gobbled up in that in that desire, in that pursuit, and there's nothing left over for the kingdom of God. And that means so much because Jesus has rejected the things of the earth and has given his whole soul to God. And we know that that sense of giving one's whole self to God results in the journey of rejection, yes, results in the journey of death, yes, but also results in the journey of resurrection and exaltation. So in giving one's whole soul to God, one actually gives nothing away, but to take one's whole soul and to pursue the things of the world, that they will be lost in death, actually gains nothing. What good is it if one gains the whole world and loses one's soul? Or what will one give in exchange? Now, the word exchange, interesting too, because it's the only time that this word is used in our Bibles. And the word for exchange is like a mathematical word. And it actually means this substitute payment. What would you give me in exchange? So the idea of you can do a fine or jail time, the fine is given in exchange. The idea that what could be given in exchange? And the image behind that word that the first people would have understood is that on the last day when the Father breaks open the windows of heaven, as we said last week, and the Son comes down as King of Kings and Lord of Lords, and all the accounts are opened up, and the real reality of people's lives are laid bare before God. That if we've invested our whole lives in the pursuit of the world, at that point, there's nothing that we can give in exchange for the time, exchange for our devotion, exchange for our focus, exchange for our love for those things that we have pursued so much. In a sense, it's a way of saying there's nothing that can be undone about that or in that moment. And then Jesus uses another word. Now this word is interesting too, because he says, if you're ashamed of me. Now he's saying, he knows that shame is coming, that rejection and suffering is coming. And he knows that if you're ashamed, if we're ashamed, he says to his disciples and the multitude, so he's speaking over their shoulders unto us also. If we're ashamed, then God can't own us at that moment either. If you're ashamed. Now, it's interesting that what happens with that word, because the word ashamed, it means we are actually ashamed, that God ashamed of that suffering. And so at the end, what Jesus is saying to the disciples, to those people around him, he's teaching them, he's introducing them to the Easter journey. The Easter journey where Christ would increasingly focus on the things and the will of God, where Christ would increasingly deny himself and take up the journey of the cross, until on that Good Friday, we call it, on the day of his crucifixion, he has lost everything except he's holding on to the cross. He's embracing the will of God. He's embracing the mission of God to be that person that would restore the relationship between humanity and God, the Trinity. And he's that person who's living out the vision of God, that one would come as not as a political king, but as a suffering servant. And he is one who is embracing those values of God. Self-denial. Oh, self-denial. Embracing God's plans, embracing the value of personal investment. My friends, this is the true introduction, a true introduction to what we will see Jesus live out in the next weeks. But there is one neat thing that happens. That second word, the word for exchange, that word the Apostle Paul picks up on. And in the Greek world, there's families of words. So pretending the things you put on the beginning and the end of the word changes the root of the word. And that exchange word becomes the word for the price that is paid to exchange price, and becomes the word reconcile. That it's out of that exchange that the relationship between God and humanity, that sin is dealt with, that animosity is dealt with, that sense of separation is dealt with, and that humanity and God is reconciled. So there's a little something here that happens, that there is no exchange on that last day. And yet, in another way, God offers us Jesus Christ as the exchange, as the one who will exchange themselves for us, that we might have all of God's goodness and all of God's grace and all the blessings and grace of God, and that Jesus on the cross would take all those things in our lives, things we call sin, and that Jesus would take them from us. And leave us forgiven and whole, would leave us forgiven and reconciled to God. My friends, the second week of Easter, welcome to the Eastern story and the wonderful hope that is given to us. But we have to admit, it's a difficult conversation. It's a difficult conversation to realize and to talk that we need a Savior. We need Jesus. It's difficult for us to humble ourselves. It's difficult for us to not think like Peter and James and John did with all the glory of the world, but to take that journey of self-denial. These things are very, very difficult. And God knows that. And God's going to show us how to do that as we walk through Easter. Amen.
Little more like kindness, goodness, love. myself. In these moments no one sees, Lord, help me be. A little more like mercy, a little more like grace, a little more like kindness, goodness, love and faith. A little more like patience, a little more like peace, a little more like Jesus, oh, a little less like me. A little more of living, everything I preach, a little more like Jesus, a little less like me.
Once again, thank you for everyone and their generosity toward Marshall Memorial United Church. We began this morning thinking about structure and thinking about all the people that provide the structures into which we come, our devotional structure, our worship structure, structure of our church life, and this structure, this beautiful, beautiful sacred space that God has entrusted to us. Thank you for your generosity that these structures might be maintained with health and vitality. Let us pray. Jesus, again, thank you for your grace and your goodness in our lives. Lord, we pray that you would protect us from all that is going on in the world today. We pray for protection. We pray that we would be in the right place at the right time and not the wrong place at the wrong time. We thank you for everyone who contributes, that creates this dynamic that we have as the church. Most of all, we thank you for your Spirit and your providence and your presence that guides us, that keeps us, that empowers our worship together. And we will give you all the praise and the glory, Lord. Thanks for the opportunity to give and to contribute and to participate. In Jesus' name, amen.
I'm back, and I just want to thank you for worshiping with us today. And I want to remind you that in this coming week, you're going to be testing out reading scripture before checking your phone and one 24-hour period of Sabbath keeping. God bless.
Thanks, Judy. And thanks to everyone who has been part of our service this morning, one way or another. It's so good to join together and to collaborate and to create God's service. A couple of announcements. So as we leave, remember that we have the Common Rule book, which is the backbone book to our study. We still have a number of these available. And if you'd like to pop by the church and pick one up, they're on the little desk in front of the pastor's office. And I just also want to take a minute and recommend Difficult Conversations, a great book that can really help us have those conversations with people and understand the dynamics around them so that we can be successful as we relate to others. Let's share a scripture as we leave this morning. For us who believe in him who raised Jesus our Lord from the dead, Jesus was delivered over to death for our sins and raised to life for our justification. The Easter story in a sentence. Amen.